Planet X Filmworks, number one show on the interweb. I'm your host, Ross. Microdeli Part 2. Of course, we've got... I'm going to do something super unprofessional here and lean off screen because it's PXF. I don't even have my background blurred. That's how hard we're going. But at least you can see the stuff I show you now. It's not blurred anymore, which is great. Just as I was doing that, an ad came up in the background. I closed it, but you're going to go to Amazon and get In the Shadow of Mount Diablo, The Shocking True Identity of the Zodiac Killer by Michael Rodelli. MikeRodelli.com. Check out his YouTube channel. Check out the Patreon below, guys. I've actually been posting some things relating to my research on the many film adaptations of The Most Dangerous Game, so I posted the first few there. I've also posted them in the community tab. And we have a bunch of usual shows and news coming up. Just check out the poll I posted in the community tab for what review you guys want this weekend, either Monkey Man or The Crow 1994. Without further ado, we're going to bring in Mike, and we're going to be covering DNA today, a new topic we didn't really touch last time, as well as some new things, and have him do a little bit of intro for our special guest. Mike, how you doing? Welcome back to the show. Mike, can you hear us?
Thank you. Good to be here.
Yep. Mike, you want to give us a little bit on the on your suspect and some background on your book?
I can hear you.
Yep. I think you're still having some delay, Mike.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Can you hear me?
We can hear you.
Okay. Well, you stole my thunder there. You showed the picture of my book, so I guess I'm going to have to show it. I'm Michael Deli. I'm the author of In the Shadow. Okay. I'm the author of In the Shadow of Mount Diablo, The Shocking True Identity of the Zodiac Killer. You can hear me?
Yep, we got you. Keep going. Oh, looks like Mike dropped, so I'm going to go to the next guest in the meantime. Special guest of the hour. Welcome to PXF, the most professional show in the interweb. Second guest is up. I'm going to do a little bit of an intro for you on the suspect. Holly Toschke. Cousin of Inspector David Toschke, making her debut on the show. Welcome to the show, Holly.
Hey there. Thank you so much for having me.
So let's get into how you fit into the equation. So you have been assisting Mike in some research. The suspect is Shel Cavalli. This is a basically at the time, late 60s, famous European car importer, car racer, horse owner. The equestrian thing is more Mike's bag thing. I don't know anything about horses, but I read that in the book. So obviously we'll be covering the Silky Sullivan, and Holly's actually lined up some new correlations and some things that we're going to be covering. You came about this means testing Mike's research on the suspect. Is that correct, Holly?
Yep. Just doing my own due diligence. I was really impressed with Mike's work. And so I went down the rabbit hole, and here I am.
Awesome. So, we're going to get into the nuances, but, you know, this is quite a different situation because this is like, you know, as Mike and I covered on the first show, a suspect that is spotted basically directly at the site of or right outside of the site of Presidio Heights, whatever you want to call it. Was there anything just, I know what you're going to go into in these notes later. Is there anything specifically that hooked you? Was it just the suspect's background, or of course Mike found him by means of a letter written to the editor, much like how is it the Zodiac used to write to the letter to the editor in correspondence?
It was a combination of things. I've always believed that the Presidio Heights crime was committed by someone who knew the area really well. You know, Mike's interpretation of the map, the bus bomb mm-hmm. map in the book, that really caught me. I thought that it was really remarkable.
Yeah, I like that too. I mean, I'm sure you heard me push back on Mike when I had him on. It's just it doesn't fit perfect, so it's.
No.
I think for people that don't know the case as well as us three, it's a little bit more complicated for them to understand.
No, absolutely. And there are a lot of things. I think the most remarkable thing about Sal Cavale is that of the known persons of interest, there seem to be more unique connections between Sal Cavale and the Zodiac and things that we do know about the Zodiac. You know, we know the Zodiac loved cars, for example.
Yep.
And, you know, Sal Cavale's life was about cars. And,
absolutely.
You know, he knew back roads intimately. You know, so it was just the compilation of Mike's research all kind of pieced together. And, you know, I my curiosity was piqued, you know.
Absolutely. Mike, welcome back. Do we have you? I think.
There he is.
I think you're still facing delay, Mike. We're gonna carry on while we work on these issues with Mike. And more importantly, the thing that Holly is presenting today is let's see if this works. Boom. So a lineup of articles and correlations that you have with points basically about, you know, things that line up with the suspect, Sal Cavale. So wherever you want to begin, Holly, if you want to take us up to the top of your list here.
Well, you know, first of all, that we know that Sal Cavale participated in a lot of races on Mount Diablo. And obviously Mount Diablo was, you know, was seemingly important to the Zodiac. So the illustration of the auto path is essentially right there. It goes up to the summit. Nothing, you know, exciting, but just notable, you know, going that far back.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously the next one, students plan European tour.
Real quick, Holly, sorry to break up your flow. Can you pull your cursor and just raise it to the top left page? Because I think it's the document is cut off. Oh. Is that all we can see is midnight?
Okay.
You can see what's on the screen.
Oh, yeah, I see what you're saying.
Sorry about that. Just so you're all good. Yep. Right there. There you go. That's the top. That's the top right there. Good. Okay. And then just pick up wherever you are going next.
And so, you know, the next thing in 1938, just a blurb about him planning a European tour on motorcycle. You know, obviously the Zodiac was very familiar with particularly the sounds of motorcycles. He liked to write about them. So, and, you know, it happened right around the time of what would become the Blue Rock Springs murders, you know, mm-hmm. in July.
Mm-hmm.
And then going down just a bit, you know, I'm not going to go through everything. I don't want to bore everyone, but...
No, you're good.
But then, you know, in 1946, we have an article about him being a member of the Oakland Ski Club and their main competitor being the Sierra Club, which just kind of, you know, made me think about the Pete Through the Pines card and how that text is noted there. And then one thing that Mike covers in his book pretty extensively. Hi, Mike.
Yeah, we can hear you, Mike.
You there?
I think you're a little delayed, Mike. I'll contact Mike on the back channel here. Yeah, I think you're delayed, Mike. Sorry, brother. All right, carry on, Holly.
Mike covers this extensively in his book, but on July 5th, 1947, there's an article about Sal Cavale having, you know, or excuse me, it happened on July 5th. where in near Auburn, he witnesses these flying discs, as he called them, and along the American River. And so again, the date, the 7/5 date, is, you know, notable, because the zodiac seems to like dates.
The anniversary of Blue Rock Springs is what you're referring to. He right. commemorates the UFO sighting with the second canonical crime.
Right. Obviously, it was very significant for him. The article made, I think it was front page news, and you know, in some publications. But it was published throughout Northern California, so he definitely got a fair amount of press from that. And we see that in the San Mateo Times article. And then we go down just a little bit. Again, we see another article on the 8th. Same thing. So he definitely got some good publicity from that, because he was quoted in mm-hmm. all of these articles. So definitely seems like a very remarkable experience for Cavalli, and like I said, Mike goes into that more in his book. But and then if we go over to August of 1947, it looks like Sal Cavalli, he was obviously in the Navy, but he was also in the Naval Air Reserve, and he was a flyer. So he basically saved a young man's life, a young man who had a broken back, and flew him, I think it was, they picked him up from Fresno and brought him to Oakland. So what was interesting about that is that as a Naval Air Reserve member, he would still have access to the commissaries, right? Mm-hmm. Or mm-hmm. that would be my speculation. So if we're talking about, the infamous wingwalkers, right? Even though he had served in the military before, but, he would have had access after as well. So,
And the flight angle is certainly interesting as well, with all the, would-be yes. aerial maps and such, So there
right.
does seem to be something there.
Right, definitely. And, later, I think in the early 70s, Sal Cavalli would also help produce a movie that was narrated, or documentary that was narrated by Orson Welles. And it was called Above San Francisco. And it was completely aerial of the city and the area. And I think that was like 73, 74, if I remember. But definitely, again, that aerial connection.
I didn't even know that. I knew about Mike and I talked the other film, that one that he wrote off on the taxes, but that's interesting too.
Right. Yeah, no, I came, that's one of the things that I came across down this rabbit hole.
For sure.
And, Orson Welles, huge name, right? Citizen Kane narrated it. I mean, very big deal. Big production. It premiered at the North Point, just like The Exorcist did.
I like it. Yeah, I mean, Orson Welles, I want to say, had something to do with that Heart of Darkness production that never finished.
Right. He was extremely well-known, had a very memorable voice. So, obviously I can only imagine that this must have been a big deal, even for someone like Sal Cavalli, right?
Absolutely.
Go to a premiere like that, be able to brag about it, that type of thing. So, the aerial connection is definitely there. And so then next up, next up was what appears to be his first letter to the editor in 1948 to the Oakland Tribune. And he wrote an open letter about the UC Cal Berkeley Bear game against Washington, and it's pretty, you know, it's pretty lengthy. But again, you know, we see, you know, even going further back than 1969 with the editorial that Mike, you know, talks about in his book. I mean, obviously, two decades before that, you know, he's getting an editorial published. Mm-hmm. So definitely, you know, an interesting thing to me. And then the next little blue blurb is a feature about Cavalli and his soon-to-be wife and traveling the back roads of Northern California. And, you know, he was an avid car racer, but a part, you know, between the Mount Diablo race and then these other, you know, kind of off the beaten path races that he did, clearly he was getting a lot of publicity for those as well.
Sure.
So, you know, and I have to just say that I had no idea that his name would return so many hits. Mm-hmm. In newspapers. I just had no idea. Anyway, it was just very fascinating how much had been published about him.
Since he was young,
you know?
Yep, absolutely. Now, I mean, I think it's interesting, right? Because on one hand, it shows that obsession with the media reaction, which Mike hammered home in the book. But, you know, the pushback we got to give, and I think we got Mike back on mobile here, if you have anything to jump in with, Mike, is that, you know, I've seen people say that, you know, he's on the radio all the time, then he's on these TV commercials and whatever else. I mean, Mike, is it too famous of a face to be at these Zodiac? And I know there's no witnesses at the first two, but, you know, there kind of is at least somewhat, if you count Hartnell seeing him under the mask at the second two canonicals. So is it too famous of a face for people not to recognize him at these crimes?
I think that his the talk about him being, you know, prominent on TV and everything is exaggerated. I've never seen a TV commercial except for the Bank of the West commercial that he was in 2012. Yeah, but I've never seen him in contemporary 60s commercials.
Sure. Anything else, Mike? Because you're good to go.
Let me try to catch up. Mm-hmm. Let me see here.
So we just got to the editor. What did we just get to?
We are right at one of your favorite articles, Mike, the more about hill climbing in an MG from 1949.
Oh, okay, yeah. Well, let's go back to the beginning. The first article about Cavalli in any San Francisco newspaper was on August 1st, 1948. He was in the San Francisco Chronicle. It showed him driving the back roads of Millbrae, so it showed that he liked to drive the back roads. When you have when you're driving a high-powered sports car, you can't open it up to 80 miles an hour down Market Street. It's just impossible, so you take it to the back roads. This is how I think he got acclimated and used to seeing Blue Rock Springs and Lake Herman Road, maybe even Lake Berryessa because he had a ranch up near Lake Berryessa. He would take these cars out and he would take them on drives, and I think that's what he did. He just drove around the area. The other thing is that's important is that date, 8-1. His first article was a Cavalli was 8-1-48. Zodiac demanded that you print his first letters and get his first publicity on 8-1-69. There's a match in the dates. So I think that that's what's important about that first article. I think he commemorated that first article, the first coverage that he got personally by trying to get coverage of Zodiac on 8-1-69. Let me keep going here. What year are we up to?
Keep it going, Holly. Well, I think it's just easier. 40s. Yeah, I think it's easy for Holly.
Well,
to
you
keep
know
us
what
on
it
the
is?
Timeline.
I know, but I have important things to say. The problem is I can't see this. Hold on a second. How do I make this thing bigger on my phone? Well, I can't even read what these. Oh, there we go. There we go. There we go.
Okay.
All right, hold on. Let's talk about this flying saucer sighting. First of all, the Blue Rock Springs attack took place just after midnight on October 5th, 1969, regardless of what he refers to it as. Look, he killed on December 20th, and he called it the Christmas murder, or murders. And then he talked about July 4th. Well, it was actually July 5th. If you read what the caretaker's son said, it was just after midnight. So it was just after midnight on July 5th. I think that the reason he drove up to the couple and then left and then came back was to make sure that he was there after midnight because he wanted it to be July 5th. And July 5th was the date of his flying saucer sighting in 1947. And July 5th, 1969 is the date of the Blue Rock Springs attack just after midnight on July 5th. There's a date commemoration. When I met with Cavalli in 2006, he tried to make it sound like he reported the flying saucer sighting as a public service. Like he looked in the newspapers for a few days, didn't see it reported, so he decided to report it just because nobody else had. That's wrong. That's incorrect. His sighting was on July 5th. The first article that I saw, and I didn't see the one in the San Mateo Times, but I saw the one in the Alameda Times Star. That was on July 7th. That's 2 days after the sighting. Now, if he's out in the middle of nowhere on July 5th, he probably didn't make it back in time to call the paper to get it into the July 6th paper. So he called on July 6th and got it into the July 7th paper. And so I think that he got that thing in as fast as he could. This is publicity seeking. There's a book of that summarizes 800 and something sightings from that year. 1947 was the first year that the term flying saucer was coined, like 2 weeks before Cavalli saw his flying discs. So this was the first flying saucer flap, what they called it in the U.S. And people were reporting flying saucers everywhere after like June 23rd or whenever the first sighting was. All of a sudden, everybody was seeing them. But people would describe them as being as small as a teacup or as big as a house. They were round. They were oblong. They were disc-shaped. But the one thing nobody was saying is that they were from outer space, because I think people were afraid to voice that opinion because no one wanted to believe that we were under invasion from outer space. But Cavalli was the only credible person out of 800 sightings in that book to say that flying saucers were from outer space. In fact, in the article that came out in the Alameda Times Star, he said that he wished that they would land and tell us where they were from. So he was definitely using flying saucers to get publicity, and he made his sighting so that he put himself in the position of knowing what they looked like, and knowing that they didn't look like anything that he had seen as an airman in the Navy. So he used his position of power to say, I don't know where these are from. They're spacecraft, and I wish they would land and tell us where they were from. Let me see something else.
Yeah, let's try to boost up a little bit, Mike, because we got a bit past that. As much as I love the flying saucer story, because you guys know I'm a big History Channel guy. Take us back to where were we getting to, Holly? Past 40?
40.
Oh, hill climbing.
The 40 buildings.
Yeah, take us past that.
All right, go ahead. All right, you're gonna talk about July 3rd, 49.
Uh huh.
Or did you already talk about it? Okay, go ahead.
She mentioned
it. And I have
it.
Something to add.
Go for it.
So, again, we see another article, again, focused on Sal Cavalli and his soon-to-be wife and his brother doing his hill climbing on Mount Diablo, right? and he also, not too long after that, opened, his location in, I think it was Walnut Creek, was on Mount Diablo Boulevard too. So, and then there's a mention in the article about the quote unquote Lone Pine Pool. And it just kind of reminded me of the peak through the pines. Again, that kind of nature setting, that Sierra Club, setting that Zodiac seemed to, appreciate. So, here's Cavalli again racing, and it's huge article on him, and it just so happened to be at Mount Diablo.
Yeah, no, I like the Mount Diablo connection. Anything else, Mike?
Yeah, gonna wind me up and get me going again. Okay, so Mount Diablo was obviously important to Zodiac. he wrote the Mount Diablo letter, what's called the Mount Diablo letter, on June 26, 1970. When his autobiography came out, he has a picture of this hill climb race, but he doesn't mention the date. He just lets you figure out what the date is. And I said to myself, actually, it was 6/25/49. So for years I struggled to find where that the event, but and I don't remember his name now, but somebody who is in who lives near Mount Diablo right now told me, or I think it was early last year, to look at the July 3rd, 1949 Chronicle. And when you look in there, you see this article, but the article is referring to a race that took place exactly a week before. And exactly a week before was June 26, 1949. So this was a commemoration. Cavalli was obviously obsessed with Mount Diablo. He had some strong affiliations to it. He bought a car dealership in Walnut Creek on Mount Diablo Boulevard. They, I think, probably maybe one of the first or the first Concours d'Elegance was at Mount Diablo. So, you know, obviously Cavalli had strong ties to Mount Diablo. And when you're at Lake Herman Road and standing at the crime scene and look south, look towards where the gate is or was, what do you see in the south? The only thing that you really see because of the way the land is sculpted is Mount Diablo. And I think that's why he killed the first victims at that site, because it ties into Mount Diablo. And then Zodiac writes a letter commemorating the anniversary of this race, June 26, 1949, and June 26, 1970.
Awesome.
And that's it.
All right, Holly, can you bring us down to the next couple pages?
So then the next is just Cavalli marries Kay Curry, his wife, in Chicago, mm-hmm. Illinois. And
for no reason, neither of them had any ties to Chicago.
Yeah, that's weird.
And we'll go back to that later. But just
right, that'll be important.
I'll just say, make sure that it's out there. And then next is a photo of his British Motors garage on Pine Street in San Francisco. Again, the whole peek through the pines.
I don't know. So the peek through the pines is unauthenticated, right, Mike? So we don't actually know that that's the Zodiac, but it's definitely an interesting.
Right. But the peek through the pines is one of those cards where there was no handwriting, I think. So it was difficult to verify. It's always associated with Donna Lass,
right?
And Donna Lass is a questionable Zodiac victim, so.
Especially now, so after her remains are identified.
Right, exactly.
Take it to the next blue one, if you can, Holly.
Let me get it down there. Okay, so
53.
Yeah, here's a big one. And this one just, it's wild to me. Let me get here. There is an article, the San Francisco Chronicle, about a letter that was mailed from Los Angeles, and it was sent addressed to Corvelli at Jaguar Motor Cars, San Francisco. There was a no street address, incorrect name, abbreviated incorrect name, and it got delivered. And it just made me think of the Zodiac and all of his, most of his Chronicle letters, didn't have a complete address. And so here it is, Cavalli knows that mail will be delivered, incomplete or not. And it's just a very interesting coincidence, I guess you
call it. Yeah, I like it.
In Zodiac land.
Yeah, that's strange, but interesting.
And then the next year, he purchases his dealership on Mount Diablo Boulevard, again, the Mount Diablo. And then in 1955, Mark H. Spinelli, who will soon be known as Count Marco, he becomes a PR rep for the AFL United Automobile Workers of America. And he does his work for a few years, and it's interesting because Sal Cavalli was so intertwined with automobiles on every level.
The ties between Cavalli and Count Marco will get stronger and stronger as this progresses, you'll see.
Yeah, it's really interesting. That yeah, anyway, we'll get to that, obviously. Sure. And then next up, we see in 1955, Josh Hoag, who was a sports writer for the Chronicle, San Francisco Chronicle, and he publishes a thank you letter to Shel Cavalli and BMC for, you know, all their support and for hosting them and providing loaner cars. And that loaner cars aspect will become more important as we go down with this. But again, here's Cavalli getting, you know, I mean, a Chronicle writer is literally like praising him in a column, and anyway, just lots of attention. Then in 56,
I think the importance here is this is another reoccurrence of Mount Diablo, the Mount Diablo Concours d'Elegance.
Right.
You know, this is just another link between Cavalli and Mount Diablo, and there's many of them that people wouldn't have known. I didn't even know about these until Holly came along.
I never did searches
like this in the newspaper archives.
This kudos to Holly. This is great sleuthing. Keep it up, Holly.
No, definitely.
There's a lot of important evidence. Well, anyway, I appreciate it. Thanks, guys. So then moving to January 19th of 1960, and there is a photo of Count Marco, and he is arriving at the LA courthouse in a 1927 maroon Rolls-Royce Phantom. And that Phantom was rented by the Chronicle for him, and they made a huge production out of it. They filmed it. Actual film appeared on local news stations of him traveling in this thing. And so maroon in the Rolls-Royce world is really red. And so
there's a color called Bohemian Red.
That's interesting.
We were never able, it's funny, it's very hard to pin down when that color was created. I've tried asking four or five different Rolls-Royce experts, and they can't give me an answer as to when it was actually created. But the importance of that is Cavalli was a member of the Bohemian Club, and red, as you know, when Zodiac wrote about Count Marco in 1974, he talked about, he signed his letter, the Red Phantom. Well, here's a Red Phantom right here, a maroon-colored, red-colored Phantom being driven by Count Marco, being mentioned in the Count Marco letter. So I think that that's actually the source of Red Phantom, not the Pathé Frères film that Graysmith talks about.
Yeah, I mean, I think I've seen a lot about the film. I don't know. It could be either one or both. I mean, that's the problem with things like that.
Well, you'll see a bit more of Red Phantom as we go along. So go ahead, Holly.
Sure. Holly's muted for a sec, I think. Are you good, Holly?
Yep. Okay, I'm back. Sorry.
Yeah,
just good. To let you know, you might hear some dog whining, and that's my dog, Roo.
That's fine.
So just, you know, little disclaimer there. We got,
You're good.
Got the dog.
My dog barked in the middle of the show before, so.
Perfect. We're dog friendly. I like that.
It's a fact.
And so the next
I don't
entry,
have a dog, but if I did, he'd bark on delay.
All right. So, we got what? The Red Phantom.
So the next. So basically then on the same day, there's coverage of Carol and the Count, and it's the infamous Carol Tregoff Bernard Prince trial in Los Angeles that Count Marco, you know, he traveled to in the rented Red Phantom.
Yep.
And the picture, people thought that they jokingly thought that he was looking at the roots of her hair, because that's how close he was. And who even knows if it's a real photo? You know, it could have been, you know, I mean, who knows? But that becomes more relevant as we go down the Carol and the Count. And then we see on February 1st, he was supposed to be reporting at the trial. Now, I don't think that he really did but the publicity definitely was there. I mean, he too was a publicity hound. And so anyway, on February 1st, there's an article where Count Marco at the Finch trial is analyzing handwriting. And, yeah, you know, it's just, I mean, silly, you know, he made, you know, some kind of a mockery of it, but again, very interesting, you know, as we see later on in all the letters that the Zodiac sent. And so, you know, here's Count Marco, and he's doing handwriting analysis from that famous trial.
I just want to jump in here for a second. This Tregoff trial, I'd never heard of it before, but apparently it was a very big deal in 1960, and the Chronicle sent Count Marco down in grand style to cover it. That they wanted him to cover it, and so they put him in this rented Rolls Royce to pull up at the courthouse in to make a grand entrance. So that's how Count Marco ended up being sent by the Chronicle to cover this trial, and he made all these observations. But the Tregoff Finch trial, I guess, was a big deal at the time. You know, now I don't think many people have heard of it, but I just wanted to, you know, give some background as to why he was in Los Angeles covering a trial, because he was sent down there by the Chronicle to cover the trial. Okay.
Absolutely.
Yeah, they definitely wanted the publicity, and he, I mean, obviously he worked in PR. He was a PR guy. He was a master at publicity. And love him or hate him, you know, he had a lot of skill. And I think the Zodiac may have known that, like may have was
learned
aware,
from it.
Was acutely aware of
the Zodiac,
power of
the Zodiac manipulated
like
the press. Yeah, but the Zodiac manipulated the press. So
Count Marco was a total, you know, I mean, fraud, really. I mean, you know, he wasn't Italian nobility. He was created by Scott Newhall and Mark Spinelli. And, you know, he made that paper a lot of money. So, yeah, definitely, to me, he's a kind of a big part of this puzzle.
You wouldn't realize it. You wouldn't realize it unless you did all this research, because, you know, you just think of Count Marco as someone Zodiac wrote a letter about, but there's much more behind it than that.
Yeah, something Zodiac brushed over as opposed to behind the scenes connection.
And he, you know, and he signed, he didn't sign his name. He signed it the Red Phantom. But yet it was only, you know, it was very personal, you know, obviously. So, anyway, going to the next, we're going to go to yellow. And that's just a remark really quickly that Count Marco was born in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania on May 8th of 1918. And obviously May 8th is the date of the Badlands letter. And this date of birth was not like widely published. It was very, it was a random fact.
Sounds like your chair's squeaking.
It's Rue.
It's Rue. Yep, she's having a moment. Rue.
It's all good.
I'm losing my train of thought here.
Yeah, I like the Badlands letter. So you're over there on
Handling the dog. while you're handling the dog, I'll pick up the conversation. So Count Marco was born on May 8th, 1918, and obviously Zodiac sent his Badlands letter on May 8th. This may have been a shot over the bow of Count Marco at the time, but he didn't even know about it because he probably just thought it was a coincidence. Now, the question is, what Zodiac suspects would have known that Count Marco was born on May 8th? Arthur Lee Allen, Ross Sullivan, Larry Kane, Rick Marshall, how would they know? Cavalli, as we'll see later, had business dealings with Count Marco, and he'd have to fill out paperwork and probably show him his driver's license. So he probably had records in his office that said when Count Marco was born. So of all the Zodiac suspects, I would say that Cavalli is probably the only one who would have known what his birthday was. Okay, Holly, hope you've got your dog under control now.
Yes, for the moment. So then going next is the hold on, let me get
Examiner from
August
21.
Is the Herb Gang column, and that Cavalli was the first person on the West Coast to sell a Phantom 5 to Bill Hurrah of Hurrah's Casino.
Who even knew that Phantoms existed? I didn't even know what a Rolls Royce Phantom was until I started talking to Holly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's how it all started, the Red Phantom. Yeah. And
I have a silver cloud, so I don't know about Phantoms, yeah.
But
I wish I had one.
Yeah, so do I. Wow, they're beautiful. But, you know, Cavalli was definitely the only BMC dealership pretty much anywhere around. He dominated the market. And so that was a big deal. They're some of the most prestigious cars that are produced. And so obviously it's newsworthy. I mean, Herb Cain picks it up. So it's a newsworthy thing. And again,
is it right if I interject something about dominating the market? At Lake Herman Road on the night of the Faraday Jensen murders, there was the car that was driven by William Crow, which he said was either a Triumph or an MG. And his girlfriend was from Napa, but she lived in San Francisco at the time. If she bought the car in San Francisco, it's 90% that she bought it from Cavalli. So this car that drove along and all of a sudden saw them and started chasing them, if that was Zodiac, it could well have been Cavalli, and he might have recognized that they were driving a British sports car, and he figured that they would make as good victims as anybody, because they were in a car that he would have known that he probably sold. Mm-hmm. So the dominating the market in San Francisco could mean that he not only sold Count Marco's cars, but that he sold the MG or Triumph to Crow's girlfriend. Okay.
Real quick, guys. Real quick, Holly, let me jump in. I'm just going to take a crowd question. Which suspect do I think has the closest handwriting match to Zodiac? You guys don't know I don't do much suspecting. I've never actually thought about this, but I thought, Mike, you really didn't push handwriting, that hard in the book. So I wanted to get both of your takes. How do you feel that Shel Cavalli's handwriting matches up with that of the Zodiac letters and other Zodiac samples?
Well, I did talk about handwriting, and I talked about criminals who were able to disguise their handwriting. And I cited an example from the 1800s of a guy who could switch back between different types of handwriting. So when people say, that you can't disguise your handwriting, I think that that's a little bit over the top. You don't solve criminal cases. You don't solve murder cases by handwriting. The way you solve a murder case is by a profile and evidence and circumstantial evidence. And that's what we're talking about right here. A long time ago in July of 1999, when I first started looking at Cavalli, I had an idea that the Gilbert and Sullivan references may be a reference to there being two people, one who wrote the music or the letters, and one who wrote the music who basically committed the murders, and one who wrote the letters who wrote the lyrics. Mm-hmm. So it's possible that, and also William Crow's initial description from 1968 has two people in the car. He mentions they, and it's possible the Zodiac had an accomplice. So if Zodiac had a letter writing accomplice, that would mean that if you try to identify the murderer by handwriting, you're going to be out of luck. And also, identify him by a DNA, because there's going to be a letter writing. The person you're going to be looking at is the letter writer, not the person who committed the crimes, except for the reddish brown hair behind the stamp. That seems to be from the killer. But handwriting does not solve the murder case. Handwriting does not. What's that?
As I was going to say, also a thing that you mentioned before, Lake. Can you hear us, Mike? You're lagging.
Yeah, right. Lake Berryessa. The writing on the door of the car seems to be from Zodiac. Yeah. If that's a person who was 200 something pounds, and that's different from the person who was at Presidio Heights.
We could get into that later if there's time. Another thing, Mike's not going to like it, but Captain J, Don Cheney You know, I don't know how far off he is on the handwriting. It could be close. But Holly, any thoughts on the matchup of the handwriting?
I don't know enough about it to really kind of render what I think would be an educated opinion.
Right.
I think, yeah, certainly, you know, it's, I'm not going to say easy to manipulate your handwriting, but it can, clearly it can be done. And I don't think it takes a mastermind to do it. I do think, well, anyway, no, nothing much to offer on that.
Yeah, but, no worries. I didn't say I had a bunch to offer on it. Anyway, we could get back on track. I was just getting the crowd involved in there. If you want to pick it up at the next one, Holly.
No, absolutely.
The bottom line is you don't solve murder cases with handwriting.
Yeah,
You solve forgery cases and different cases like that with handwriting, but you don't solve a murder case with handwriting.
Yeah, I mean, I think people's issue is, like, he wrote so many letters, so does that help? Because he wrote so much, he left so many samples, or, you know, he wrote so much and we got nothing, so does it go nowhere, I think, was what Holly was saying.
Well, a lot of his letters were typed, though. Right. Weren't they? I mean, they were
only one of them. Well, only letters. Only the confession letter was
typed. Oh, no, I'm talking about Falcavale, not Zodiac.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. No, right. A lot of his letters were tight, but some were handwritten. There was something I wanted to say. Now I forgot what it was. But at any rate, I don't think that. Oh, I know. There's so many people that have handwriting that matches that weren't the Zodiac. Look at Ted Kaczynski. His writing is pretty good compared to Zodiac, from what I understand. He wasn't the Zodiac. Yeah. So you're going to find people whose handwriting. You're not going to solve the case by finding someone whose handwriting matches. That's for sure, because it's happened before. There've been other people that had. You know, I was told this. Can I tell a story?
Sure.
Or you don't want to divert too much.
Go ahead.
How long is your story?
Well, it's going to take a couple of minutes. Okay. There's a handwriting expert named Lloyd Cunningham, and he was asked to look into a written will from someone from Massachusetts to see if he had written the will out, because it had to do with how his funds are going to be distributed after he died. He was already dead, I guess, and they had to figure out, whether he wrote the will or not. And Vince Repetto told me that, he analyzed the will, and in analyzing the will, this guy lived in the Bay Area for a period of time, the Zodiac time. And when he analyzed the will, he realized that there were, like, out of the 25 characteristics of Zodiac's handwriting, this guy had 19 of them or something. Mm-hmm. So all of a sudden he thought he might be Zodiac. So he took it to the forensics meeting, and without telling anybody, whose handwriting he was looking at, he put up samples. He put up samples of the guy's handwriting and Zodiac's handwriting. He said, "How many people think these samples match?" And like 90% of the guys raised their hand. And then he said, "When it's the Zodiac killer case, how many people think it matches?" Nobody raised their hands because they don't want to be wrong about saying that someone's handwriting doesn't match or does match the Zodiac. None of the people in the room would raise their hand to say that it was similar, even though 90% of them, before they knew it was Zodiac, raised their hands. So, you're not going to find experts that want to go out on a limb and say, yes, that guy was the Zodiac killer because of the handwriting. You're not going to find it. So handwriting is just a diversion.
Other than Sherwood Morrill, he seemed to go in pretty deep at times, and he kind of lost me with some of his statements. You know what I did see, Mike, was eBay has a book, I guess, about Shell or by Shell or whatever that he autographed. It's going for like a couple thousand, last I checked.
Wow.
So have a, I'll send you guys the link. It does have an authentic signature, and there it is authenticated.
That was funny. I had a bunch of signature pages from him, and I threw them out. I didn't have the books. I just had the signature pages, but I threw them out because
probably worth some money.
Yeah, I know. I kick myself for that now. I remember looking for them. I couldn't find them. So, all right. Go ahead, Holly.
Nice job, Mike. Carry on, Holly.
Okay.
I was trying to get palm prints off them, by the way.
Ooh, that would have been... I would have liked that.
Yeah. Damn. so the next entry is... we're at February 1961, and we have a Count Marco column, and entitled "You Can Learn a Good Deal from a Thoughtful Groom." And anyway, he mentions that women should care for men as if they are her prize horse. Very, you know, obviously tongue in cheek, but you know, we have the horse, and we know that Till Cavalli was a horse guy, and and then in May of 61, he starred in a documentary. I think it was a series that Herb Cain did.
Is Holly breaking up, or is it just me?
No, she's good. She's not breaking up.
You hear me?
Okay. Carry on, Holly.
Really? Herb Cain had a series of 1 hour segments, I think, and they were called Baghdad by the Bay. Mm-hmm. And Till Cavalli starred in one entitled All About Automobiles. So definitely we see that Cavalli, he knows Herb Cain and quite well. And
what kind of series is this? This is a series of articles?
It's a documentary about different automobiles. And I'm sure about his dealers. I've looked for it online and I haven't found it. But I'm sure it's all about his dealerships. And
maybe we can find a VHS or something.
Oh, that'd be awesome. Yeah.
I'll dust off the VCR.
Awesome.
Yeah, right.
You know. But, you know, obviously, you know, it shows that he's got, you know, he's definitely connected to Herb Cain. And Herb Cain will mention Till Cavalli quite a bit as we go further.
Absolutely.
The next is going to be in April of 1962. And it's about the Concours d'Elegance that Till Cavalli either founded or co-founded. It was featuring Scott Newhall, who was the executive editor of the San Francisco Chronicle at the time. And I believe he was an honorary judge. He was a judge in a few of them, over time. But obviously, we see that Till Cavalli also knows the editor of the San Francisco Chronicle, Scott Newhall. And they're connected because Newhall loved vintage cars. He loved to race and he loved horses. So they have a lot of things in common. And so it's just kind of funny.
And they probably met each other at the Bohemia Club, because the Bohemia Club was originally founded by newspapers, and there were a lot of newspaper people and executives. So they probably hung out together at the Bohemian Club. So they probably knew each other.
The point being that he definitely knew the editor that he knew the editor that Zodiac was rushing those letters to.
That's strange.
Here comes the Red Panum. In October of 1962, there's a Count Marco column. And it reads, "Dear Count Marco, instead of sneaking up on women like a red phantom with black paint, you should work openly and usefully to help this free and generous country which feeds their nasty face." And it's signed Chicago. And so I know Mike will want to talk about this as well, but here we see Red Phantom. It's the first time that it's sent to Count Marco. And it seems, I've read that it seems to be referring to when Count Marco was looking behind Kara Tragoff's head and the roots. The media kind of made a joke of it. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's interesting because Till Cavalli was married in Chicago for some reason.
No reason. Well, the only reason was that they had the biggest Lutheran church there. I think that's what he went to. He found the city with the biggest Lutheran church, and he got married in that one. Other than that, they have no tie. The family has no ties to Chicago.
Was he a big Lutheran guy?
Well, I don't know. I mean, I don't know anything about his church going behavior. All I know is that he was that most Norwegians are Lutherans.
Interesting. I can't help but wonder. Now, this is interesting, Holly. So, The red Phantom with black paint, that seems to be much more specifically to the car reference and less so to the Spanish film that Mike referred to. That slipped by me. I didn't catch the black paint the first time around.
Yeah, and my understanding is that I think they do layers, and there's a black layer, and that's why they kind of, maybe that's why they appear maroon, kind of, you know, instead of like true, like what we interpret as a true red. I don't know enough about it, but that, you know, like that seems like that could be very plausible, you know.
I mean, who knew that someone was talking about 12 years before the Count Marco letter, that someone was talking about Count Marco with a red Phantom in 1962? Who knew that? I mean, it's incredible.
Yeah, it's pretty wild.
And there's another reference coming up.
Yeah. So now I'm going to go to March 3rd of 63.
Quick car question. Are all the Rolls Royces imported, or do they have any production?
No, they don't produce any of them in this country. They're all imported. Okay.
Right, they're all imported.
Carry on, Holly.
Okay, so the next article is from March of 63, and it mentions a very plant that Cavalli is building a national reputation for flamboyant press parties. So we see that he's being recognized for, you know, knowing how to get publicity, knowing how to market. He was known, very social person, he and his wife.
I'm sure he met Scott Newhall. I'm sure he met Scott Newhall at those parties, probably.
Yeah, well, Newhall was a big, like Lucius Beebe and Newhall and Cavalli and Count Marco, they all loved Rolls Royce. That was their thing. They were definitely connected by a love of that car. And especially especially vintage models. So, it's just, again, interesting. Now here, and this is one of the first, little tidbits that I came across when I first started searching last year. And this absolutely blew my mind. But it's an ad for Sal Cavalli's British Motors, and it's an ad to sell Count Marco's El Dorado. And it says, you know, it's an El Dorado Biarritz. I'm not sure how to pronounce that.
Biarritz. This is Biarritz.
Biarritz. Okay. And it reads, formerly owned by Count Marco. So obviously we know that Sal Cavalli knows Count Marco and was, you know, doing business with him. And I just found it incredible that it even said that. You know, it was such a marketing tool to list that Count Marco, you know, was the owner.
Yeah, that's wild.
This proves that Cavalli knew Count Marco, definitely. And there's other instances of this. Probably he was getting rid of his Eldorado Biarritz because he bought a Phantom or he bought some other British car from Cavalli. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. He ended up owning two or three Rolls Royce, and we'll see that later.
So weird that there's even an article that would even cover that. I mean, I'm sure it was maybe normal, more normal back then, but
it's not an article. It's an ad. It's an ad.
Right.
Yeah.
That's interesting. But it's in the chronicle.
It was just like, you know, Count Marco was so marketable, right? Anyway, it was pretty wild when I came across it.
Is it written that way, formerly owned, or is it formerly owned? I was just wondering, is that the way it was written, formerly?
Yeah, because he sold it.
Yeah, but that's not the word you use. It's formerly, not formally.
Right. That's a...
Okay. Well, okay.
I don't know if that's what it said or not.
It should be formerly.
Okay, formerly. Yeah, that's what I thought.
My lack of spell check there.
Okay.
But no, that was a worthy question because of Zodiac's, misspellings.
Right, you're forgiven.
I couldn't see Cavalli
misspelling things in the formal, like publicly seen ad. I wouldn't see him doing that, but no, that's right.
No, I'm glad you
agreed, unless he did it purposely, you know what I mean, which he didn't in this case. Carry on.
No, I misspelled it. So, but good. I'm glad that we clarified that because it would, you know, it's just a, you know, an ad.
I wrote you about that later. I mean, earlier.
Oh, you did. Right. Okay.
Are we 64?
So now we're in 64 and another article about Sal Cavalli, and this time the remark is that he looked at 44, that he looks about 10 years younger. And so, you know, and he did. He looked quite young. I mean, he was in great physical shape.
He looked younger than his age his whole life. So people that say he was too old or whatever, they just have no idea what they're talking about. He always looked younger. It's not how old he was, it's how old he looked to people.
Mm-hmm. Right. And so, yeah, it ends up in an article about him. It's interesting in that sense.
Sure.
Then in 65, there's a photo of Sal Cavalli's 1913 Rolls-Royce Phantom. And there's that Phantom again. I believe it was white. I don't think it was red, though. But... anyway, notable.
I'm sure he had several.
Red Phantom was used with regard to Count Marco, not to Cavalli. So
true. Yeah. Oh, yeah, that's true. And so then next, in April of 66, there's a huge article on Cavalli. And the interview was photographed at his near his Oakville home, where his near Napa, and there's a photo of him with a Dalmatian, and so as Mike will comment about this, but you know, the night of the Stein murder, Palisetti claimed to see a man walking a dog in Presidio Heights. So, you know, we now know that Sal Cavalli definitely had a dog and actually interacted with it at least for publicity's sake, but. Mike,
he talks about that dog very fondly in his autobiography. It was the Dalmatian. He was apparently very attached to that dog, just like he was attached to Silky Sullivan.
Oh, okay, good. And so now in 1966, here's Cavalli again writing an editorial, but it's an editorial to Ralph Nader, who was scrutinizing, I think it had to do with the emissions of the vehicles, but anyways, it's just a letter from Cavalli to Nader, and it's, you know, published in the paper. So again, we see his, you know, he likes to write editorial letters, right?
I wonder how common that is to write a letter to someone else and have it published. It seems like another thing more so back then.
And especially, I mean, it wasn't like in the letters to the editor. You know, it had its own like column.
Right.
Oh, is that right?
Oh, right. Very specific.
Yeah.
Well, it just shows you how much clout Cavalli had with the Chronicle.
They gave him a spotlight.
Right. You know? Similar to the thank you note we got from Josh Hogue, you know, 58, you know, dedicate a lot of text space to thank him and praise him. So anyway, so that with Nader, similar. Now in 66, we see that the ad for that year's Concours d'Elegance is a Phantom. It's a red Phantom. I think it was a Phantom 1. So there's that Phantom thing again. Mm-hmm. Mike, do you have anything to say?
There's the red Phantom.
Okay. And then the next one is, I thought was interesting. In 1967, it was a big deal that John Lennon painted his Phantom 5 in these psychedelic tones and had a zodiac sign on the roof. So just kind of a funny coincidence.
I want to see that. Send me, if you have the graphics, send that to me.
Yeah, I think I do. I'll send it to you.
I want to see
that.
It's full black and white, though.
Yeah, I don't think it's color.
I got you.
But yeah,
try Googling it.
So you mean a cross circle logo on the roof?
No. It has his own zodiac.
Oh, okay, I got you.
Yeah, he was, I think, a Libra.
Interesting.
But here's, he takes his gorgeous car, and a lot of people were very offended by it.
Yeah.
So, anyway, there's that.
I like it.
You know, we know Zodiac likes to use blue meanies, which, you know, suggests he's a Beatles fan. So, you know, John Lennon, Beatles.
Yeah, I like that one.
The next one in September of 67 is another Herb Cain column, and Herb writes that he used the family Rolls Royce. When I say the family Rolls, I don't mean my family's. I mean Shell Cavalli's family at British Motors. So Cavalli was known for giving loaner Rolls Royce to the Chronicle staff and to the editorial staff. And Herb Cain, obviously, you know, they had that kind of connection, right?
In Cavalli's autobiography, he talks about the lending Herb Cain cars when he went to England. When Cavalli started building Jensens in England, he apparently, hooked Herb Cain up with cars when he'd come to England. So he and Herb Cain, I think, had a very close relationship, but they knew each other very well.
Yeah.
And you'll see more examples of that as we go along.
I would
definitely agree. And the next one's just kind of a funny one, and that's from November 1967. And it's Herb Cain again. And he's talking about how Melvin Belli receives a recall telegram from Rolls Royce. And that Belli is quoted as saying, "I'm in total shock. In fact, I've just gone through 3 law books to find out what my state of total shock is worth." Now we have Belli. Cavalli was the only BMC dealer in the area. Who knows, that telegram could have come from them, right?
Plus that means that Belli bought his British car from Cavalli. So there's another link between Cavalli and Belli.
Right.
Cavalli has a nexus to all these people: Count Marco, Belli, Herb Cain. There's this nexus being created by Holly's work, and it shows that Cavalli had a connection to all these people that show up in these letters or that are mentioned.
Yeah, I agree. Do we know what the recall was for? Is there anything specific, Holly?
I don't remember.
I don't think Herb Cain would have mentioned it. Mm. I don't think Herb Cain would have been that specific. He just had little blurbs, so I think that's probably the whole blurb.
Yeah.
Makes sense.
Yeah, I think I quoted, well, at least I quoted the Belli part of the blurb because I thought it was hilarious.
Absolutely. Yeah, that's amazing.
And the next up in August of 68 is another Count Marco column. He was syndicated in so many papers. I had no idea. Oh, my goodness.
Count Marco was known across the country.
He was nationally known. And I mean, he had his publicity tours were massive. I mean, just a lot of people loved him and they loved to hate him. But
polarizing.
Just amazing.
There would be articles that would say Count Marco has come to town or is coming to town, like a big announcement. Yeah. You know, like he was a big guy.
They would rent like a Rolls Royce for him because they knew that he loved Rolls Royce. I think that happened in Dayton, Ohio.
Circus.
Whole town kind of came out. It was a huge production. So he was a very big deal. Here's a Count Marco column where entitled "Don't Criticize Him in Public," and where he's quoted as saying, "Marriage is a business, and if more American wives behave like sales managers of large organizations, they'd be much better off."
Wow. And of course, Cavalli married his secretary,
right?
Which, yeah, according to Richard Walter, allows him to bring the power of the employer-employee relationship home with him at night.
Yep.
Crazy.
So it's a power. It's a power move when you, you know, when you marry your secretary.
God, crazy. So now I'm going to go to the next mention of Red Pingham and Count Marco Colum. In January of 1969, it reads, "Dear Count Marco, instead of sneaking up on women like a red phantom with black paint, you should work openly and usefully to help this free and generous country, which feeds your nasty face."
And that's the exact text of the other letter.
Right. And then it says, "You must belong to the Ku Klux Klan," misspelled, "the way you talk about American women." And it's signed, "Happily Married."
Now, yeah, the two letters strange. Say Chicago and Happily Married. The person who was happily married in Chicago is who? Shel Cavalli. Oh, wow.
That's pretty interesting. That's pretty interesting.
So, you know, and the misspelling of the mention of the Ku Klux Klan and the misspelling, you know, Shel Cavalli was an immigrant, so it's interesting, help free this generous country. He's very American, you know, they come across kind of Americana. Mm-hmm. And so just, you know, interesting that, you know.
Well, the other thing is that this proves that the 1962 letter was probably from the same person, because yeah, it uses the exact same text and then it adds on to it at the end. Yeah. And of course they talked about a red phantom again. So there's a red phantom, and you know, there's the same text as appeared in 62. How many people would have written down, you know, text that appeared in 62 and then copied it not 7 years later? It just wouldn't happen, I don't think. This is the same person reiterating what he wrote and regurgitating, basically, what he wrote in 62, and then adding some other insult to it and signing it Happily Married. And when you combine Chicago with Happily Married, you've got Shel Cavalli. Okay.
Yeah, I like it. That's bugged out.
And, keep going, Ollie. Yeah, it's almost like a kind of a joke, like a secret joke, you know, yep, red phantom with black paint, like their own like language or something.
Yeah, like code words or something.
Yeah, yeah, it's, yeah, anyway. So then the next is another Count Marco Colum, where he writes, "Astrologers in the past have tried forecasting my birth sign, but have given up." So just, you know, silly little blurb about astrology.
Well, in other words, not many people know his birthday. You know, right, if you don't know someone's birthday, right, you can't do his chart. Yep. So this is just another way of saying that, yeah, that he's that Arthur Lee Allen wouldn't have known his birthday, and neither would Larry Kane or yeah, Ross Sullivan or Rick Marshall. Okay.
I'm all right. Okay.
Hopefully, just go ahead, Ollie. I think you dropped
a little blurb in May of 69 about a motorcycle scramble near Lake Herman Road. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that's pretty obvious.
There's a lot to about the gang, motorcycle gang activity, Holly, and how whether right, or not that could be blamed for, you know, the murder of David Faraday and Betty Lou Jensen. But anyway, neither here nor there. Carry on.
Okay, so now we're getting to the part that I think is really telling about Shel Cavalli. And I'll let Mike kind of talk about this more. But in May of 1969, an ex-CHP sergeant writes a letter to the editor of the San Francisco Chronicle. And Mike, do you want to go ahead?
He's muted right now. It's saying you're muted, Mike, and you got to unmute if you can hear us.
Yeah, it's going to happen. Mike, you there? Well, anyway.
Just carry on. It's showing him as muted, so you got to unmute, Mike. Go ahead, Holly.
It's about primarily law and order. And, you know, it mentions World War II, the Gestapo, you know, Hitler. And it's the letter that Shel Cavalli will respond to in his letter to the editor that Mike came across, you know, that started Mike on this path, I think. So next one is Count Marco Colum. Women have threatened to bomb me. Love these little tongue-in-cheek blurbs, you know, just there's, you know, again.
So like, what you're saying, the bus bomb letter, it could be all related or whatever.
It's just again, he's writing about these things, and it's clear that, you know, Zodiac read the paper and read Count Marco's column.
Yeah.
So
yeah, the references, you know, get thrown back and forth.
It's just you know, anyway, I just included it because I thought it was a kind of cool.
Yeah, I agree.
Now the next one is June of 69, and it's a Count Marco column, and it's just crazy. The misspellings. It reads, "What would this great country be if George Washington and the other great men of the country hadn't protested against England?" It's got misspellings and incorrect capitalization. And so it just reminds me of Zodiac. Mm-hmm. You know? Mm-hmm. Mike, got anything to say on that one?
Now that I'm unmuted? Yeah. I'm trying to, you know what, I'm having trouble with the spreadsheet now. I can't go backwards in it. Like, it's stuck on 622.69.
Right. Because we're going to get, yeah.
Yeah, she's on the Hitler stuff.
Oh, you didn't get to his letter yet, right?
No, she's on it right now.
I'm going to let you do that one.
She's on the Count Marco thing.
Well, on 626.69, Cavalli sends a letter to the editor of the San Francisco Chronicle. And when I first started my research, I thought, because what happened was, going from 626.69, 626.70 is Zodiac's Mount Diablo letter, and then 626.71 is another article by Cavalli that was put into the two newspapers in England about Jensen Motors. Of course, that's one of Zodiac's first victims, Betty Lou Jensen. Mm-hmm. I thought that this was the start of the pattern. But actually, when I learned about the race at Mount Diablo, 626.49, that's actually the start of this pattern. So in order for him to get an article into the Chronicle on exactly the right date, I think that he knew the editor, he knew the people at the Chronicle, and he was able to say, "Hey, could you please publish this letter on June 26, 1969? And I think that's what happened, because he was able to commemorate from there. You go June 26, 49. June 26, 69, June 26, 70, and then June 26, 71. You have four June 26 dates, one of which is in 1949. The rest of them are sequential, 69, 70, 71, with both with Cavalli and Zodiac alternating. So I think that he was able to get this. This was sort of a custom designed letter to the editor that he was able to get in on the date that he wanted it in it. And I can't prove it, but it's just such a coincidence that it happens to be on June 26. So I think that the pattern June 26, 69, June 26, 70, June 26, 71 is preceded by June 26 of 49. And that's where I think, so this letter marked the 20th anniversary of the Mount Diablo hill climb race. And I think, obviously, as we talked about before, Mount Diablo was very important to Shel Cavalli and to Zodiac. As far as the letter to the editor goes, it's funny. When I read that letter, and I have it right here, I see things like a bloody confrontation, referring to young people as militants and lawbreakers. When these young people lie dead or wounded in the street, you, your publisher, and some of your columnists must take a large share of the blame. And of course, Zodiac went after Paul Avery.
Yep.
And there's a mention of Hitler. There's a mention of power, and I think that's what the letter is actually about. It talks about the editor having the more opinion-making power than any other single individual. And I think that Cavalli viewed the newspaper as misusing its power to support the militants and young and lawbreakers, which were the young people that Zodiac was killing. When I see all these different elements, it's like an encapsulation of the Zodiac case. When I met with Cavalli, he said, "I don't see anything in the letter that means anything." You know, he just completely blew it off. And other people blow it off too. But I think that if you look at it, there's elements in this letter that are definitely related to the Zodiac case. Even though he's not mentioning the Zodiac case per se, he's talking about elements that were part of the Zodiac case.
Sure.
So that's what got me onto him to begin with. When Ed found this letter, he sent it to me. And then the other thing is I recognized Cavalli's name at the end of the letter because I was into horse racing and Cavalli was a horse owner and I recognized him from the racing form. And so Ed reached back 30 years, pulled out one letter. It could have been any letter written by anybody and it happened to be written by somebody I knew. And then, you know, that didn't make me say this guy must be Zodiac. We did more and more research. And as we started to find, he looked like the sketch. He lived near the crime scenes. He wrote me on monarch-sized paper. All these things started to fall into place. This guy made himself into a suspect by the things that he did and said, and by the things that that he sent me, the letters on monarch-sized paper.
Yeah.
So
that part's pretty true.
Anybody who thinks that I looked at his name at the bottom of the letter and said I'm just going to make him the Zodiac because I know who he is crazy. You know, I wouldn't have tried to make him the Zodiac. In fact, I thought that we were barking up the wrong tree. I said this guy. You know, when I found out this guy was made of money and lived in Presidio Heights. You know, it's not the type of person you think would be a serial killer. Everyone tried to dissuade me. Oh, guys like this don't become serial killers. He already had power in his own life. Why would he need to kill people? On and on and on and on. And all I would say is, hey, the evidence is pointing to him. You know, I don't know anything about anything. All I know is that the evidence is pointing to him. And the more evidence I got, the more pointed at him. So anyway, you can pick it up now, Holly. Thanks.
Yeah, go ahead,
Holly. I was just going to go back to June 25th, the Herb Cain column. Mm-hmm. And it's about how the police commissioner, his Chinese cook, was attacked in the neighborhood. And the neighborhood was Pacific Heights, which neighbors on Presidio Heights. And, you know, it has this dramatic police car swarmed into the elegant neighborhood too late.
Like in the Zodiac case.
Right. Mm-hmm. Right. And again, the timing of Cavalli's editorial letter it was newsworthy because it was, you know, in a good neighborhood. It got special attention from Herb Cain. There's that one. And now where am I? I am. Okay, so now during this time, Shel Cavalli had hired the first lady jockey in the Northern California, definitely in California, but she didn't work with him for too long. But she was staying at his Napa, or she referred to it as Napa, at his Napa home at the time.
And it was widely rumored that they were having an affair, by the way. Yeah,
interesting.
Which would be, given the timing of, you know, what happened at Blue Rock Springs, that the timing would be interesting because, you know, after August of 19, we find out that after 4 months of working with Cavalli, she's now working at Phantom Stables, which was a competitor of Cavalli's. So,
obviously the affair didn't last.
Yeah. That's clearly funny. Clearly.
Our man Peekaboo Pennington should have been on the case, Mike. Was he still active?
Maybe he was.
But it also got Cavalli a lot of press. There were so many articles because she was also very beautiful. She had been an MGM starlet. So she was this gorgeous jockey. I mean, she was groundbreaking. And Cavalli got in those 4 months, he got a lot of press. So
I believe it.
If nothing else from a marketing standpoint, you know, he presented as, you know, equal rights, you know.
She ended up landing on her feet. She ended up marrying Fred Astaire. So.
Right. And she was a fraud, too. Basically, she had made up pretty much all of her life. including the fact that she was a starlet. So yeah, she was kind of, she was just a persona, really.
Much like Count Marco.
Exactly.
She was a jockey, though.
Right. Yeah. She was that. No, that was about it.
hold your place real quick, Holly. We have some questions for Mike. What size boot is KQ? Mike, he's tall, right? Wasn't he a tall chap?
I have no idea. I have no idea what size shoe he wore. He was 5'9".
Okay, not overly tall. Carry on, Holly. Sorry.
No worries. Where am I now? So now on, let me go back. I am disoriented. Please forgive me. What going on here? All right.
Hey, what, Mike? Oh, yeah, we have a guy who's not very happy with KQ here, Wezzy87. He said there's nothing that connects him to Zodiac.
Tell him to read my book. Tell him to read my book.
go grab a copy of In the Shadow of Mount Diablo, Wezzy. It'll change your whole perspective. It'll change mine. Carry on, Holly. Do you know where we are?
So July 1st, there's a letter to the editor that's actually a response to Cavalli's letter of June 26th. And it's interesting because the writer remarks, you know, Cavalli, who was so critical of Chronicle editorial policy, the fact that the Chronicle put his letter in the letters to the editor column is proof that this great newspaper is one of the greatest and most fearless yet truthful in all of the 50 states. And so, I mean, this guy just completely kind of annihilated Cavalli's point, you know, his position in his editorial, in my mind. Definitely called him out and, you know, so there's that.
So it seems like they're trying to declare themselves heroes because they posted a opposite perspective of, you know, a scathing review of themselves. Yeah. But let's keep it real that they did that for the publicity because it creates that, did you see what the Chronicle posted? They posted an article that criticized themselves. It creates a hype fairness, in itself.
An element of fairness. And Newhall knew that. Newhall was also a brilliant businessman. You know, he knew how to run and market the Chronicle, and he knew that there was a lot of money in personalities like Count Marco and Herb Cain and letters like that. And Cavalli, obviously, you know, he knew how to write. He wasn't afraid to write, and he definitely took advantage of seeing his name in the paper.
Absolutely. Yeah. So let me jump in and play devil's advocate, guys. So why does Zodiac need to know Melvin Belli and Herb Cain and Count Marco and all these people? Because what the naysayers would say is all of those people are public personas. They all have articles public. I mean, if he has a subscription to the Chronicle, he's going to know who they are anyway, right? So do you think it's necessary for him to have that personal relationship, Holly, since Mike just dropped?
Well, and maybe it may mean nothing. That's the honest truth, right?
Right.
I mean,
right.
I try to be very objective, in terms of my own analysis, it could be nothing at all. It's just remarkable that these, you know, yes, they were known columnists. And it's not like Chel Cavalli was the only person to know of them.
Right.
But it's interesting because Zodiac definitely interacted with these personalities. He wanted their attention. He knew how to get their attention. There was a certain, I don't want to say intimacy, but like, a
familiarity, maybe.
Yeah. He just... he again, like I said, it could mean nothing at all.
Now, I'm not trying to trip you up. I'm not trying to pin you down. No. I'm just asking your opinion.
It's a fair question. It absolutely is. And like I said, I'm one to admit that I don't know. It could mean nothing at all. It's just when, in comparison to the other known persons of interest, it's just interesting that Cavalli has these connections.
Absolutely. I mean, I like the fact that it's primarily, besides the media angle, it's primarily a car connection. For me, personally, I think that's what stands up. Did you hear my question, Mike?
Yeah, I did.
What's your take?
Well, one of the things that hasn't come out, I don't know if the article was in here or not, but Cavalli presented himself as being somewhat of a feminist. There's an article that Holly came up with that showed him loaning in the years, in the 50s or something, some women were having a protest or something. And he loaned them a car to organize their protest in. He was into women's tennis, and he had the first female jockey. So I think that he was somewhat of a feminist, and I think that Count Marco would have probably offended him. I think that if someone had a suspect other than Cavalli, and they could make links between Cavalli and Herb Cain and Scott Newhall and Count Marco, I think they would consider that an asset. Sure, you didn't have to know him, but I think that Cavalli knew Count Marco. Zodiac wrote a very personal letter. He wrote it directly to Count Marco, the last letter he wrote. And I think that the relationship between Cavalli and Count Marco may be what spawned that, because Cavalli was a feminist and Count Marco was an anti-feminist.
Mm-hmm.
So I can see where Cavalli would have been, in particular, would have been irked by Count Marco. So, I mean, it's not necessary, I guess, for anybody to have known them. But when you can make these links between the suspect and all of these personalities, I think that is one thing that, makes him a more interesting suspect than someone who doesn't have any, than Arthur Lee Allen, who was living
absolutely
in the garage or something.
I agree. I just, I just wanted to see what both of your answers were. Of course, you guys know me. I got to play the middle for the audience.
Of course.
Yeah. A little bit for Joey Bernath. Sounds like you wanted their acknowledgement. Zodiac's letter to Belli was his best handwriting work. I think I pointed that out last show, Mike. Anyway, carry on, Holly.
The next one is just briefly July 28th of 1969, and Herb Cain kind of pokes fun about the recent extraterrestrial happenings, and says, or perhaps you're undergoing an identity crisis. So, just kind of poking fun, and, obviously,
harkens back to the UFO.
So yeah, we know Cavalli has his, had his interaction or his... had an incident. So.
Contact.
Right. Oh my God. Oh wow. I see a movie in the making there. Wow.
I might direct that one. It'd probably be a low budget B movie. Okay.
Awesome. C movie, definitely.
So
that's then, just a little blurb that it's August of '69 that it's newsworthy that he's hosting a Labor Day party. At his Napa ranch or stud farm, I should say. And so again, it's just crazy. And, this was newsworthy. And
yeah, that's wild.
Obviously he spent a lot of time at that Napa ranch, so he definitely knew that area quite well. Now,
and we're getting at Lake Berryessa is what you're referring to here, Holly.
Yeah. Oh, sorry. Yes. Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
It just shows how good Cavalli was at getting publicity for anything he did, especially from the. Was that in the Chronicle or where was that? We don't know.
I think it must have been I think it was Chronicle or the Examiner. I think it was local.
Yeah. So he's got a major newspaper announcing he's having a Labor Day party.
Right.
Yeah, so that's ridiculous.
He's just very, very good at getting publicity. Which Zodiac was. I mean, this
shows familiarity with the North Bay area. Most importantly, he said, I also killed those two kids in the North Bay.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Kind of North Bay, kind of sounds like that. But I don't mean to mess you up. Carry on, Holly.
Oh, that's okay. And so the next one is September 23rd, 1969, and it's concerning the upcoming Concours d'Elegance at the Silverado Country Club on September 28th. And Scott Newhall was going to be among the honorary judges. And so we know, so that would have taken place on the 28th, so the day after Lake Berryessa. So we know that that Kawale was a founder, and very active, at the Concours.
This places him in the area. This places him in the area too. Yeah. You know, 27th was the day before. So the 28th, this places him in the area.
Yeah, that's for sure. Interesting. Real quick, Mike, KQ criminal history. He's kind of an upper crust chap.
No, that's the whole thing. This is a guy. This is the last guy anyone would have ever suspected.
Squeaky clean, Mr. Flack Nasty. No history. I didn't realize you're going to have this much material, Holly. What do you want to do? Do you want to talk DNA, Mike, or do you want us to keep trucking? Because we can, if you want to come back and do part two, Holly, we can cover the rest.
Yeah, I don't want to bore everyone.
No, I'm liking this, but I know you want to talk DNA, Mike. So do you want to switch gears or
whatever you want to do? If you want to switch, we'll switch to DNA.
We got you here, so let's just make a note of where you're at, Holly. Where did we get to?
Yeah, no, I'm fine where I am.
We got to.
We're definitely to. Well, we're to around the time of Lake Berryessa.
Okay, so the Napa, so like 7701 Napa Register, right around there?
Because
we just did...
Yeah, so the next one we'd be at... We did 923.69 and 927. Yeah, 926, and so 928 is just the event. It's just, you know... The event itself, the Concours itself. Again, day after Lake Berryessa, so he's in the area with the editor of. Wow, that must have been interesting for Newhall.
Yeah, I know, right?
Wow. Wow.
Okay, so we got to the Concours. Okay, cool. Yeah, so we'll pick it up at. We'll pick it up at Lake Berryessa next time, but you can just stick around, stay on with us. Mike, you there?
Yep, I'm here.
So let's get your. I know one thing that you definitely. Let me get us back to. What do you guys like? This. I think this is good for now. One thing that I saw you saw, Holly, was I know Mike has made some videos about the DNA. And we had some pushback here from Michael Morford, Mr. O'Deli of the Zodiac Speaking Podcast. Let me find this. Yeah, I wish I could pull it up for you guys. It's super long, so I'm gonna read the Mike Morford take, and he was kind of pushing. So Rodelli has made his statements on his YouTube channel and also raised the question of the viability of the Zodiac DNA sample. And this is Morford's response. Mike is wrong in his video. He says he doesn't know when and if technology will be available to get DNA from the hair.
Yes.
Holly's in the thread. She pushed back on this already. Okay. We'll get both responses. We'll be get DNA from the hair behind the stamp on the letter. Well, that technology exists right now in 2024. DNA could be extracted from rootless hairs. Because Mike doesn't know something like this, cast doubt on everything else he says. Plus, Rodelli is so invested in his suspect being Zodiac, he himself doubts all of the evidence because it doesn't point to a suspect. The simple truth is it is going to take physical evidence to solve this case, prints or DNA. All that being said, I'm not sure why they gave behind the scenes or what is taking so long. But make no mistake, it will take physical evidence to solve this. He also keeps talking about DNA work that was done 20 years ago. DNA science and technology has evolved 1,000% since. That early work was done. Whatever testing, analysis of work was done back by then, and all of it should be redone using the latest techniques. He posted a interview he did with Susanna Ryan, who works at a DNA lab. So, Mr. O'Deli, your response to Mr. Morford.
Where do I start? because I'm honest enough to say that I don't know something, I don't know anything. I mean, you know, I was being honest at the time. Now I know. Yeah. He says that DNA can be extracted from rootless hair. What type of DNA? He doesn't say whether it's nuclear or mitochondrial. I learned that mitochondrial DNA can be extracted from 2 millimeters of hair. So they easily have 2 millimeters of hair behind the stamp. How come they haven't developed mitochondrial DNA? They don't want it, because mitochondrial DNA not only doesn't eliminate people, but it also it can only be, you got 3,000 suspects, most of whom are probably dead. So you have to go back to all the suspects and find the matrilineal line of that family. You can't take it from like their sons or daughters, because they're passed down from the mother to the son and daughter, not from the father. So the father would be out. So you have to find a sibling. In my suspect's case, all the siblings are dead. There's one person, I think, in the family tree who would have mitochondrial DNA passed down from his sister, from the mother to his sister to her son. There would be one person that they could test mitochondrial DNA on. But this would create a logistical nightmare, because they'd have to go back to all of these suspects, find the matrilineal line, get a sample of DNA, and then hope and match. They have to run all these samples. You know, imagine how many thousands of samples they'd have to run. It's sort of silly. As far as physical evidence being required to solve a case, I worked with Richard Walter, and I've recently been looking through all the notes I took on Richard Walter's conversations with me, and I learned so much from this guy. It's really a treasure trove of information that I got from him. And one of the things he said is that the way you solve a case is you develop a profile, you find somebody who fits the profile, and then you develop a circumstantial case against them. And that's what I did. I sort of did it backwards, because I developed a suspect first before there was a profile. When I developed Cavalli as a suspect, I thought, like everybody else, that Zodiac was a low-life loser. He was a guy that crawled out of the Tenderloin every night and killed people and then, you know, crawled back in. So I didn't know anything about a power assertive or Zodiac being a wealthy man. Mm-hmm. And when I heard Walter's profile of a power assertive, it sort of reopened my investigation, because at that point, Cavalli had been ruled out against his phony DNA from 2002. And I do criticize the DNA because it's phony. The whistleblower from 2018 said that there was no DNA. So that means there was no DNA in 2002, and there's no DNA now, as far as we know.
Mike, you've seen this stuff about Tom Voigt's post about the Vallejo PD, how they sent it out to the lab, and, you know, whatever year that was, but it took, you know, multiple breaks in between. Voigt provides a couple updates. He eventually comes back to us and says that when they got the sample, it's someone that can't be the Zodiac, so it either means female or non-Caucasian. I mean,
yeah, isn't that, that's very convenient. You know, they sort of nixed my argument about there being no, and Alan, well, my argument is based on what Alan Keel did. And, you know, what Alan Keel did was state of the art at the time. And so if Morford is right and science has advanced so much, where's the Zodiac DNA? Where is it? They've never said that they have it. They're always looking for it. And they're always talking about more sensitive techniques. But if Zodiac never licked the stamps and envelopes, I mean, Keel's technique in 1998 was able to identify two letters that were loaded with cells, loaded with DNA, and loaded with saliva. So it was able to detect saliva, and it couldn't detect it on any of the Zodiac letters. And I think what happened was, the reason why there's some cells, few cells, you know, on this chart, some saliva, some cells, is that that's what happens when you analyze contamination. You're going to get some cells. You're going to get a little bit of background amounts of saliva. That's all Keel found, was background amounts of saliva on all the letters. So I think that he established a pattern about these letters, and the last 20 years have proven the pattern, because they're using all these sensitive techniques. But where's the DNA? If it were there, they would have gotten it by now. They would have gotten it when they had PCR in 2002. They can't find it because it's not there. And I think that we're being duped into thinking that these letters are eventually going to, DNA is eventually going to be found with a more sensitive technique from these letters, from these stamps and flaps, that's going to solve the case. Well, I contend that they were applied with water, and that you're not going to get any DNA from them. The only place you might get DNA is from that little hair, and that little hair, you can get mitochondrial DNA. I've been trying desperately through my source, who's someone who took the place of Paul Holes and Contra Costa. I won't mention names, but you can, if you know the players and you know who I'm talking to, unfortunately, I've been able to get information on mitochondrial DNA, but not nuclear DNA. So I don't know how much hair it takes to get my nuclear DNA, but I can tell you this. In general, hair has very little nuclear DNA in it. So I would imagine it's going to be more than 2 millimeters that you need for mitochondrial DNA. How much more? If you need a centimeter or 2 centimeters, forget about it, because you only got like 4 or 5 millimeters of hair, 6 millimeters maybe. You know, that's an estimate. So if you need a centimeter of hair, you're not going to have enough. And there's no guarantee that once they do get sensitive enough techniques that they'll be able to develop anything other than mitochondrial DNA. And mitochondrial DNA will leave them absolutely nowhere, because you'd have to do all of this work to run all of these samples, you know, tie up a lab and all the money and all the time, just hoping that somebody's mitochondrial DNA is going to match. I just don't see it happening. So,
yeah.
And the other thing is, let me talk about genetic genealogy for a second. Hold on a second. I'm going to leave for a second.
No worries. I'm going to hold it down with the crowd. Most probably two different people at Lake Berryessa. One guy the girls saw who was good looking and in shape in the Zodiac, and who apparently wasn't. But we don't know if that lurker was an accomplice. Go ahead, Mike.
All right. I don't know if you can see it. Probably not. It's very hard to see. This is a book called The Cavalli Family. This is a book of genealogy that was done in 2000 on the Cavalli family. There's pages and pages of genealogy. If you're a member of the Cavalli family, you don't have to put your DNA into some database to figure out who your ancestors are. You just open up this book and look. So even if they get DNA and it doesn't match anybody, if they can't, you know, they put it into CODIS and it doesn't match, and then they go mitochondria, then they do genetic genealogy, they probably won't find any of my suspects' relatives in the databases, because they just have to open up this book to figure out who their relatives are. They don't have to do any genetic genealogy. These people were so rich that they did their own genealogy. So as of 2000, they could have figured out who their relatives were. And if any were born recently, they probably know about them. So I don't even know if genetic genealogy would solve the case. Even if my suspect is Zodiac, which I believe he was, I don't know that genetic genealogy would even solve the case.
Do you still have the letters that when Cavalli wrote to you, Mike?
You know, I was stupid enough to give them to SFPD, both of them.
Oh, man. We don't have the stamps. SFPD has the stamps. Dude.
Now, what happened was the first letter that I got, I remember I was working for Lucent Technologies at the time. This is when I first started out. This was still in the summer of 99. Mm-hmm. And I went to the cafeteria and I got a pair of plastic gloves. And I very carefully opened the letter, made a copy, took the letter out, made a copy of it for myself, and then sent the original envelope with the stamp and the letter to SFPD for analysis, and never heard anything more from them. And then what happened was in 2012, I had the second letter still. But again, I got excited. Vince Repetto was getting my material up to the level of the chief. I wanted to show them exactly what I had. So I sent them the second original. And I shouldn't have done that because I already tested. I was able to set up a gizmo at home with an aquarium, and I was able to get a heater and a lamp and whatever, a fan and a heater. And I was able to do my own crazy glue fuming of these letters, and I never found any fingerprints on them. I put my handprint on the back as a control. People know what a control is if they know anything about science, so that something would develop if the technique worked. My handprint would develop, and my handprint developed, which showed the technique worked, but there was nothing on the front where Cavalli had signed them. So I didn't get any palm prints. So I should have just left it at that, but instead I sent them the letter. And of course, now it's in the bowels of SFPD, and God forbid I can't get it back. So I don't have any of the original letters that Cavalli sent me. I have one original envelope left, and that's it.
Yeah, I was just thinking about the sticker sample. So that being said, Mike, you covered in the book that Cavalli supposedly gives up his sample willingly to SFPD, was it?
So sure.
Would they still have his sample on record?
No, because if you watch the show, SFPD never had his DNA. ABC had it. And I'm sure he had an agreement with ABC that it was going to be destroyed as soon as the show was over. They got the numbers. John Kanonis came in and said, well, what about this? He showed it to Cindy Holt. She said, no, I can look at it and tell that, you know, I don't even have to look at the other samples. I know that that doesn't match. But of course, my contention is that Zodiac didn't lick the stamps and envelopes, and that DNA was proven to be a contaminant. The like I said, the whistleblower said that there was no DNA as of 2018, and there never had been any. That means that DNA was not from Zodiac. So what do I care if he didn't match it, you know? Yeah, I mean, at the time, I thought it was eliminated. I mean, they actually eliminated my suspect on national television, knowing that they had DNA that wasn't from the killer, because they knew that that wasn't, they knew that that was a contaminant. They knew that that probably wasn't from the killer.
Yeah, absolutely.
Now, good. I haven't gotten into the stuff I wanted to get into, so I don't know if you want me to get into it now or want to wait or what you want. What I want to do. I mean, I've talked about DNA, but I haven't really talked about, you know, what I want to get into.
DNA wise, keep it rolling.
Okay. All right. So in 2002, you know, I began cooperating with ABC News in 2001, and they read my report and they said, "Oh, you're onto something important. This is incredible. This is like something we've never seen before." And, you know, so then the end of 2001 came, 9/11 came, and the whole show got tanked. It got put on the shelf. Then in 2002, they started up again, like in the spring or something. And Harry Phillips told me, "Oh, we're going to, SFPD's lab is cash strapped. We're going to give them money to try to develop DNA from the letters." So I thought, oh, great. So then sometime later in the summer, he told me that they had gotten Cavalli's DNA and that they had developed a sample. And the show was aired on October 17th, 2002. And, you know, Harry Phillips called me up before and said that that was at the time that the Belt, Washington, D.C. sniper was active. And he said, mm-hmm. "Your suspect didn't match the DNA. We're going to take you out of the show. We're not even going to have you in the show at all if the Washington D.C. sniper attacks during the show." So I was going to be out even, but he didn't attack, and so they had me on, and they showed my segment, and then they showed that Cavalli didn't match the DNA. So these people had the nerve, SFPD had the nerve to eliminate a viable suspect on television and destroy my credibility against DNA that they knew wasn't from the killer. So the next, and to show that they knew this, Lyndon Lafferty, the late Lyndon Lafferty, who wrote a book about Grant as being the Zodiac in 2012, his ears went up when he heard they had DNA, because he wanted Grant to be compared to that DNA. And so he called SFPD the next day and spoke to Maloney on the Friday. I guess the show was on a primetime Thursday. On Friday, Lyndon called and he talked to Maloney. And during the course of the conversation, Maloney said, "Well, that DNA was premature." And so Lyndon responded by saying, "Well, does that mean it's invalid?" And Maloney paused for a few seconds and to consider his answer, and then said, "Yes." So here they are using invalid DNA to eliminate my suspect, and they were admitting this the day afterwards. So then Sidney Holt comes along, and I'm sorry, she was there at the time. So Ray Nixon, who was a Zodiac researcher, I don't know if he's active anymore, but he was a big supporter of Arthur Leal. So he had no axe to grind with my research. He wasn't like a sycophant or a friend of mine. But he came back and he told me that Sidney Holt had actually lifted up the stamp and swabbed underneath and gone in between the flaps and tried to find DNA and couldn't find any. So that's why she sampled the outside of a stamp, because she had to. I think that what happened was when they agreed to work with ABC News, they may have had a quid pro quo where ABC News said, "We'll give you money, but you have to give us something for our show." And so in order to give them something for their show, she went to the outside of a stamp, a single stamp, I think, got DNA, didn't know who it was from, could have been a contaminant, and then they said that that was Zodiac DNA, and that's what they eliminated Cavalli against, and Allen, and another suspect. So it was a joke. I mean, the whole thing was a joke. It was a charade, and the whole thing was, I think SFPD thought that Zodiac was watching the show that night, and they wanted to scare him a little bit, and they wanted him to think that they had his DNA. So that he would make a false move, he would kill somebody, he would write a letter, he would do something stupid, and they would catch him. Well, that whole thing backfired, and the net result was they ended up eliminating Cavalli and two other suspects against DNA that wasn't from the Zodiac, and they killed my case there for several years until I was able to slowly, and I was ready to give up. I mean, Harry Phillips said, "You should apologize to Cavalli and hope he doesn't sue you." So I did. I wrote a letter of apology, an email. I sent it to ABC News, and they sent it to Cavalli. And I apologize for, you know, any distress I caused him, not knowing that he had been eliminated against DNA that wasn't from the Zodiac. Now, the flip side is, why would Cavalli offer his DNA if he knew he was Zodiac? And the simple answer is, he also knew that he didn't lick the stamps and envelopes. And he had to roll the dice a little bit. I mean, you know, he didn't know that about the hair behind the stamp, but they still haven't gotten DNA from that.
And we don't necessarily know if that hair is Zodiac, but it probably is.
Well, I mean, Zodiac was described as having reddish-brown hair. Cavalli was described as having reddish-brown hair, and the hair behind the stamp is reddish-brown. So,
yeah, sure.
You know, I think that there's a good chance of this from Zodiac. You know, maybe not 100%, but I think there's a good chance. At any rate, agreed. Cavalli didn't know about that, probably. Or maybe he did. I don't know what his connections were at SFPD. You know, he might have known about the hair, but knew that it couldn't be analyzed or something. But if he was Zodiac, he knew that he hadn't licked anything. So I think he had to roll the dice a little bit, because if he would have said, I'm not going to offer you a sample of DNA, that might have made SFPD say, what the hell's going on here? You know, why won't this guy offer DNA? What's he hiding? So I think he was sort of forced into rolling the dice, knowing that he didn't lick the stamps and envelopes, knowing that he applied the stamps with the sponge and water. And so he gave them this DNA. And of course it didn't match. And then he had me on the ropes for many years. So I'm very bitter about what SFPD did to me. They had no right to do that. But because I think they had a quid pro quo with ABC, they had to give them something. And that something that they gave him was DNA from the outside of a stamp, which could have come from anybody. So,
yeah, so is that the definition of premature? It was DNA on the outside of the stamp that they hadn't verified? I mean, I'm still confused by that wording. I think that almost anybody would be, you know.
The outside of a stamp?
Yeah, well, that him saying, you know, the DNA is premature, you know? It's like, and then he says...
Well, I guess they weren't ready to put it into primetime television and say that it was Zodiac's DNA.
Right.
And then, he
says it's basically invalid, too. So it just, yeah, it's the whole thing seems shaky, like you said.
Well, you know, Maloney seemed to have known something. He was on the inside, and he apparently knew something that nobody else knew. And that's why he said it was invalid. So, you know, probably it was a one-off sample from one stamp, from the outside of a stamp. I mean, you have to verify that by finding the same DNA on the outside of three stamps. You can't just take one potentially contaminated stamp and say that's Zodiac's DNA. When you can't find it behind the stamp, you shouldn't go to the front of the stamp. And that's not where you go. I mean, what they should have said was, Zodiac didn't put his DNA on these stamps and envelopes. We can't find it, and it's not there, and that's it. But instead, am I still on?
Yeah, you're still on. I just okay. I put you forefront.
Oh, okay, because I lost your picture.
I'm still here. I'm just letting you take the spotlight.
That's all right. They used DNA that was from the outside of one stamp instead of, I mean, any scientist who has any brains at all, like I studied science, you'd know that if you're going to take a risky sample like something from the outside of a stamp, you have to verify with finding it in other places. You can't just, especially when you looked under a stamp and then the flap, like Holt apparently did, swabbed specifically under a stamp to where the Zodiac's DNA should have been, and she couldn't find it. That should have been the revelation on the show. Zodiac's DNA isn't on the letters. Not, we found this DNA on the outside of a stamp. Well, they didn't admit it. They didn't admit it was the outside of a stamp. But the behind the scenes, they knew that they had Zodiac's. They had DNA from the outside of a stamp that may or may not, most likely not, was Zodiac's, because those letters were handled by a lot of people. But instead of verifying it, they just went with one sample. And you know, they knew that he didn't. You wouldn't be able to lick the outside of a stamp and not lick the underside of a stamp. You know what I mean? It doesn't make any sense.
Sure.
So once
sure.
he found out that, once she found out, once Holt found out that she couldn't get DNA from the underside of a stamp using PCR, which is a very sensitive technique, I don't think you need to go much more sensitive than PCR when you're talking about someone that licked a stamp and envelope, because if they lick it, they're putting tons of these cells on the stamp. And if you can't develop it by PCR, there's something wrong. And I don't think that this whole thing about needing more sensitive techniques, how sensitive a technique do you need to develop DNA from a stamp that was licked? You don't need that sensitive a technique. But that's what they're leading people to believe, because people want to believe that only DNA can solve the case, because that's what the police have been saying. And I think they're just running out the clock on the case. I don't know that they'll ever get nuclear DNA from the hair, maybe in, you know, 20 years or something, but that doesn't help me. Right. And, you know, unless I'd live to be 90. I just think the whole thing is a joke. Anyway, so after that, I spoke to Alan Keel, and that's when he told me, you know, that there was only background amounts of DNA on the of saliva on the letters, and he couldn't get any DNA off the letters, of the true Zodiac letters. In fact, the way the lab segregates the letters, apparently, is the true Zodiac letters are characterized by having no cells and no DNA, and the two forgeries, that Keel found, the 1978 letter and one of the 1974 letters, which he didn't specify, I think on purpose, because you have to know, you have to be kind of dumb not to know which. That's a big deal when you find out that one of the 74 letters is a forgery. I think that he was playing games and being political and doing a holdback by not telling me or Lyndon Lappin.
He forgot
which 74 letter it was.
But I don't really blame some, because, you know, if he goes public with that to you and then you make it public, it comes back on him, right? So I can see why he didn't get a straight answer.
Yeah.
Not that it's my favorite thing in the world.
He's not even with SFPD anymore. He has his own company now. And when you write to him and ask him questions, he doesn't even respond. So, he's just still playing political games. It's all politics. You know, it's all police politics.
Alan, if you're out there and you want to come up and clear things up for us.
Yeah, if anybody knows. If anybody knows which, I've been crucified over which 1974 letter is the second forgery. I've said it's the Exorcist letter. It's probably not the Badlands letter from what we heard tonight, because that's on Count Marco's birthday, probably sent by Zodiac. It's not the Count Marco letter.
Yeah, but Badlands, it's unauthenticated for one, for two. It has the super neat handwriting with the big words, so...
Right.
The Zodiac writer all of a sudden just became a genius, and he forgot that he misspelled all those words.
He was always a genius. No. This is what I said to Mike Kelleher years ago. If you took the Zodiac letters and read them backwards from time frame, temporally, backwards, you would say Zodiac was a really smart guy. Look at all these big words he used, and he dumbed himself down.
Agreed.
So that might have been his way of saying, screw you, I'm really a smart guy. And I've been sending all these letters, make myself sound like an idiot. But now I'm going to send a letter like the Badlands letter, where I use 5-syllable words.
Right. So playing dumb the whole time. I totally agree.
Right.
Holly, so anyway, go ahead.
Oh, okay.
Go ahead, Mike. Finish up.
All right. So I'm getting there. So Keel said that he found two forgeries that were loaded with cells, loaded with DNA, which was the characteristic of stamps that had been licked. They were sent by somebody who didn't know not to lick stamps. So, and the DNA apparently matches between those two letters. So that's what Keel said. So then, I'm just giving a history of what happened. So next, Debbie Perez comes along, and she accuses her stepfather, Guy Ward Henderson, of being the Zodiac. And she says, she said that she wrote some of the Zodiac letters. That's why there's childish handwriting on them. She was only a child. He used to bring her along to watch him kill people or something. Some crazy story. And, so she said, I want my DNA compared to the Zodiac DNA that they had from 2002. So someone from SFPD is interviewed by Kevin Fagan at my request, actually. And he says DNA that we have from the 2002 may not be reliable. That's what his quote was. It may not be reliable. Well, if you're using DNA that's not reliable to rule out people, why are you using DNA that may not be reliable? You know what I mean?
Right.
So That was another hint that came along to let us know that there was something going on with the DNA. Then the whistleblower comes along in 2018, and he or she says that there, as of 2018, there was no Zodiac DNA, and there never was any, which means that the 2002 DNA was not from the Zodiac. So as of 2018, which is 20 years after Alan Keel did his research in 1998, they hadn't developed any DNA, and the only DNA SFPD has admitted to developing is very convenient. It's DNA that's on the letters, that's associated with saliva, but lo and behold, it's from someone who's not the Zodiac. So they still don't have Zodiac's DNA. I mean, whose DNA are they developing? I don't even know. I don't trust any of these people as far as I can throw them. I think that they're duping the public. I think they're playing games with the evidence. I think they're trying to run out the clock on the case, making everybody wait for DNA. When was the last update about DNA? 2021, I think, from Voight. That's two plus years. There hasn't been any updates at all on DNA. What are they doing?
And that's just VPD, right? So that's not even SFPD.
Well, whoever it is, VPD said in 2018 or whatever year it was, they were going to start analyzing the Zodiac letters, and they would have an answer in 3 years. Well, it's been a lot more than 3 years, and they still don't have any answers. So I think that the whole thing is a joke. I think that the police are duping the public, and I also think RPD is duping the public. I was going to get into RPD and their press release. Their press release.
I don't want to tie up all the time. Yeah, I shared your video on. People could check that out in the community tab from your channel of where you address that. And we can, if you want to come back with me and Holly next time, you're more than welcome. Holly, you still with us?
Maybe I put her to sleep.
let us know if you. Holly, there.
Holly. But I think Holly's stuff was very important tonight. I think it shows.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
I'm here. I really am.
I want to get your take. I want to get your take too because you were in on.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, we're getting a little feedback from you. We got an echo on you, Holly. I think you got the video on. You got to mute it.
It's not me this time.
No, it's not. If you can handle that, Holly, I don't want to kill the feed with the echo. You good? Real quick, I'm going to say, boom.
I don't know what's happening.
Okay, you're back? Thank you. All right, so I wanted to get your take, Holly, because you were in that thread with Morford, and you kind of pushed back on some things that he had to say. Did you have any more on that?
Yeah, and Holly, give it to him.
Can you hear me, Holly? I think her microphone might have went haywire on her. Well, I'm going to give you a minute, nope. Holly, and take some questions from the crowd. The thing
about Morford is he seems to like to play, I know something you don't. Like, he'll tell you, oh, it's easy. There's techniques available today to get DNA out of hair, but they won't tell you what the technique is, how much hair you need, what type of DNA he's talking about. He's playing I know something you don't know, and he's done that before.
Yeah, no, I hear you. Let's just see. Any other? I know there's a question about. So my boy Flack was kind of stuck on the fact that you didn't have KQ's boot size. I'm assuming that's just because you didn't find it, Mike, or it wasn't listed anywhere.
What am I going to do? Ask him what size shoes he? I didn't even think of it when I was. To be honest, I had a list of questions I was going to ask him at the meeting. I didn't think of asking him his shoe size. Yeah. Because let's face it, if you have size 9 feet and you want to screw around with people, you can put on a size 10 and a half boot and walk around and you still have size 9 feet. So sure. I don't really see any, you know, there's too much room for playing around. Just like in Presidio Heights, everyone says, oh, Cavalli wasn't barrel chested. Yeah, but if you put on a few sweaters underneath your jacket, I mean, obviously Cavalli didn't disguise his face that night because he looks just like the sketch. And right. his face was his way of getting out of trouble. If he got stopped, he could have, you know, if Falk had stopped him or whatever, he could, and who knows what he said to Pellicetti. He could say, you know, do you know who I am? I know the mayor, and I'll have your job tomorrow if you don't leave me alone. He couldn't do that if he had a clay nose on or a fake chin or something or a fake face. Or clay, it wouldn't make any sense. So he couldn't have disguised his face. The next thing you do was you put on a few extra sweaters, you make yourself look bulky, and you look like you're barrel-chested, and you're not. And look what he's done. If he did that, he's fooled people for 50 years. People are still saying, oh, he wasn't barrel-chested. He can't be the Zodiac. He wasn't barrel-chested. Give me a break.
Holly, can you hear us? I think we had some TV from the background. You can try to rejoin if you want, Holly.
Calling Holly.
PXF to Holly.
Paging Holly.
Zodiac files to Holly.
I guess she's...
Let's see.
How about now, Holly? There she popped up again.
Nah, I just
popping her up, right?
Yeah, that was me popping her up. He shaved
his
head.
I'll talk about RPD.
Go into it briefly. I'm trying to avoid our Riverside activity at all costs, but you can go in. He shaved his head from Berryessa to Presidio Heights, so he cut the long hair. Just a thought.
I've never been able to. You know, one of the things about Guy Caskey, I've always wondered. You have all sorts of pictures of this guy on the internet, all sorts of pictures, but none of them from the fall of '69. Nobody has a picture of this guy from the fall of '69 because he was a member of the counterculture. Now I know that some counterculture people wore their hair short, but that's because they probably they worked for the man, you know, and they wanted to look like clean for Gene, they said, when they talked about getting clean for Gene. I forgot his last name now. He was the candidate that went against Robert Kennedy, but they said get clean for Gene. In other words, when you go around to people's houses and you're campaigning for Gene, you don't want to look like a hippie, because then they wouldn't accept you, so they would cut their hair. But Gajkowski worked for an underground newspaper. He should have looked the part. So if Gajkowski had hair down to his shoulders or down to his rear end in the fall of 69, he couldn't be Zodiac, because Zodiac had very short hair. So, but I've never seen a picture of Gajkowski that I know of. Maybe some exists that I haven't seen. I don't know. But I've never seen any that show that he had short hair in the fall of 69 when he was working for that underground newspaper in San Francisco.
Yeah, and, good times.
Yeah, good times. Yeah. I mean, you know, how long was his hair? I mean, his hair should have been long. He's a hippie. Anyway, you want me to talk about the RPD a little bit? RPD.
I do not think the glasses at the Stein murder were disguised. Well, you said KQ wore them on and off, right? Glasses.
KQ wore glasses regularly. He didn't need. He. This is what he told me. He said when he first started this dealership, he was so young that when people would walk in, they'd say, "Where's your father? I want to talk to him about the car." And he'd say, "No, I own the dealership." So finally, he started putting glasses on to look older. I don't know if he needed glasses or didn't need glasses in 1969, but every picture I have of him, from the ones that I remember, he has glasses on until 74, maybe. He lost the glasses and he grew his hair out and he had sideburns. And that's how Lindsay Robbins remembers him, because that's when he met him. He hadn't met him prior. So I don't know if he needed glasses or not. That's a good question. The glasses may not have been a disguise. He may have needed glasses at that point. I don't know.
Yeah, absolutely. All right, you can go into RPD if that's where you want
to
take it.
Okay, so I'll try to make it brief. So RPD puts out a press release in 2021, which is one of the worst press releases ever released. I can't imagine anyone being worse. It's poorly worded. It doesn't make any sense, and it only tells you what they want you to know. RPD's goal is to separate the Zodiac case from the base case as far as possible. They don't want to have anything to do with Zodiac. They want to only deal with the base case as the base case and not as part of the Zodiac case. So they have this, all of a sudden they talk about this guy who was a kid in 1966 and or 67, and he supposedly wrote the Bates Had to Die letters. And the way that they found him is, I guess he sent an anonymous letter where he must have licked the envelope. I think by that time the stamps were pre-glued. So they got his DNA off of the envelope and they did genetic genealogy. They went through all this trouble and they found this guy. But then they said that he admitted that he wrote the Bates Had to Die letters. Mm-hmm. Well, people admit to all sorts of different things. You know, people, maybe it was a fantasy. Maybe he wanted to be known as writing the Bates Had to Die letters. They don't say how they linked him to the Bates Had to Die letters, which is the important part of the chain. In other words, they didn't want to tell you if they got DNA off of the Bates Had to Die letters or not, because they would be telling you something you didn't know, and they don't want to do that. Exactly. So, but here's the thing. Here's the thing I thought about. If they got, let's say they got DNA from the Bates Had to Die letters and this kid matched it, that would be the end of it. There wouldn't be people, if you say we got DNA off the Bates Had to Die letters, people from around the world would be sending you cigarette butts and spit samples and all sorts of stuff. Analyze this, analyze this, analyze this. I think my stepfather's son's, you know, daughter-in-law's father was the Zodiac. But if they could have sealed it up by saying, we got DNA from the Bates Had to Die letters, it matched the kid, end of story. That would have been it. You know, people wouldn't be sending samples because there'd be no reason to. It would match. They know who it matches already. They didn't say that. So why do you think either one or two things happened? Either the kid's DNA didn't match what they have from the Bates Had to Die letters, or more importantly, maybe they don't have any DNA from the Bates Had to Die letters. And that would prove to me that they were sent by Zodiac, because how many people weren't licking stamps and envelopes in the 1960s? If they are the same as the Zodiac letters, that suggests that they were written by the Zodiac. So I don't believe anything RPD says. They're very political. That they've lied about the case before. They said Bates was stabbed 42 times, which wasn't true. They said all sorts of different things over the years. I don't believe anything they say. I'm very skeptical about RPD, even more skeptical than I am about SFPD. But, you know, I just
I'm
have no
use
for RPD.
About it myself, but
the only people who can keep the police honest are the press. If they write about it, the police had to respond. I pleaded with this reporter from Riverside in the fall of like maybe 2022 or something. I sent them all this evidence. You know, the other thing is that they developed the DNA from the hairs, the three hairs or something that were found in Bates' hand in the blood clot. They were able to get mitochondrial DNA from the hairs. They compared it to the prime suspect. It didn't match, but they wouldn't eliminate him. And they said that the reason that they wouldn't eliminate, one of the things I heard that they wouldn't eliminate him is that they said the hairs may have blown out of the head of one of the on-scene investigators into her hand.
Yeah, from Santa Ana Winds. That's my favorite one.
Yeah, the Santa Ana Winds.
Crazy.
Such nonsense, you know, such nonsense. But this is the type of stuff they say. Then they even top that. They said, well, we don't know if the hairs were from Sherry Jo Bates or not. They may have been her own hair that she pulled out of her head at some point. And that's what ended up in her hand.
The wrong color.
No, she's the wrong
blonde.
Color.
Yeah, she's
right,
blonde.
Anyway, brown.
Yeah.
But the thing is, here's the thing, is that her brother, Michael, I mean, immediately when they get developed mitochondrial DNA in 2001, I talked to Michael Bates after 2001. So he was alive in 2001. All they had to do was go back to Michael Bates, who had the same mother. This is where mitochondrial DNA analysis comes in. You go back to the sibling that has the same mother. I assume that he had the same mother as Sherry Jo. The father was married to the mother. They had two kids. You check his mitochondrial DNA and you see if it matches the hair. If it does, then you know that it's Sherry Jo Bates. They didn't even think of doing that, apparently, or they didn't admit to not doing it or whatever. I mean, how stupid can they be? They're just dumb.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's just bad science. And I just hate seeing this bad science being done in the name of, in the name of the Zodiac case. They're playing games, or they're just not very bright, because I would have gone right back. I mean, if I were running the case in 2001, I would have gone right back to Michael Bates and gotten a sample of his DNA if I knew it was passed down from mother to children, because he's her brother. He should have the same mitochondrial DNA. If they didn't even think of doing that, then, you know, that's their problem, not mine. But
that's the first thing they would arrive at, as you said, and for some reason, I don't know.
Right.
It seems to didn't occur to them, or they know that and they didn't do it for some reason. You know, that's the only two options.
So they said that we can't rule out what do they call him, Bob Barnett, against the mitochondrial DNA, because we don't know who it comes from or. Whatever. I mean. Plus, she had blonde hair, and the hairs in her hand were brown.
Right.
I mean, if
now,
Bob Barnett,
so there's a lot more that came out on the Bob Barnett thing. Supposedly, Bud Kelly had some sort of vendetta against him. So
right, Bud Kelly.
Bob Kelly. Barnett thing really fell apart recently. Whereas it seems like Kelly had some beef with him for some reason, might have just been screwing with him, you know.
Don't forget, Bud Kelly is the one that was convicted of molesting his granddaughters or something.
Yeah.
So, and when they said, listen, when they said that the hairs might have blown out of the head of one of the on scene investigators, guess who one of the on scene investigators was at the time? Bud Kelly.
Yeah, that's what we were trying to verify when we did another show on Riverside. Yeah.
That's what I heard. I heard that he was one of the on scene investigators. He was a patrol officer and he was on the scene.
Yeah.
This is a theoretical. Let's say that when they developed the mitochondrial DNA, the first thing they did was go back to all the on-scene personnel to rule them out, which would make sense.
Mm-hmm.
If they thought that the hairs might have blown out of somebody's head, that would make even more sense. And it matches Bud Kelly. Well, they have two choices. They can either say Bud Kelly killed her, or they might say, nah, Bud Kelly wouldn't have killed her. You know, this is before he was become known as a child molester.
Yeah.
He was the chief. Nah, yeah. Bud Kelly wouldn't have killed her, so the hairs must have blown out of his head. And into her hand, that would be the other explanation.
Yeah,
so,
I agree. One problem with that, though, is I'm pretty sure Bud Kelly's blonde, or he was blonde. So,
was he? Oh, okay,
I believe he was. But again, you know, there's a lot of like, I guess his office was locked, and when they arrested him, like you were saying, supposedly that's when they found Sherry's diary in his locked office.
Yeah, right, he had his diary
that was
locked
in 2000 or something, right? Which is, I don't know, still something weird ago. About it. You know,
I think it was 2012, if I'm not mistaken. I could be wrong about the year. But Sherry Jo Bates was blonde too, and they didn't rule her out against the hair. So
but again, that's not crack police work. But your point stands. I'm probably gonna get us out of here, guys. We're going on like 2:22. I was hoping to get Holly back. I sent her the link, but I think she may have had some...
Must have fallen asleep at the keyboard.
I think she may have had some...
I'm still up. It's 11:30 where I am.
I know, so, it's gotten late for you guys. So I'm probably going to take us out. Shout out to Holly. Appreciate it. We'll come back and we'll finish the timeline with her. You're welcome to join us if you want. Mike, go get the book. In the Shadow of Mount Diablo, Mike Rodelli, MikeRodelli.com, and you can
subscribe. 4.5 stars on Amazon, so it's worth reading.
You can subscribe to Mike's channel in the description below. Check out my Patreon. You can subscribe there below. Join the memberships. Thank you, Joey. Appreciate it. Joey's one of my vigilantes. So I got 3 levels of the memberships. There's the gorilla, the inspector, and the vigilante. We're hoping to get you back, Holly, so we'll just finish the show next week. Okay. You know, depending on you guys' timeline, and see if we can finish the KQ timeline with Holly. That's Holly Toschke, cousin of Inspector David Toschke, as I said, and of course Mike Rodelli, author of the book. Just trying to think of if there's anything else we missed, Mike, but I think we hit most of the topics.
Well, I think Holly did a good job of showing these relationships between Cavalli and all these players. So
absolutely. Absolutely.
I think these are things I never expected. I mean, I never had any idea about these things, especially the relationship with Count Marco. And, you know, kudos to her for doing all this work in the newspaper archives and finding all this information.
Yep. Yeah, that was amazing sleuthing by her. We're going to get more into the Silky Sullivan stuff because there's a couple more things that we didn't really get to hammer home there. The white paper written by David Aranchak and Sam Blake is out now. I think it came out like end of last month, about a week ago. And that's kind of their whole story of cracking the cipher. Seen some stuff on LinkedIn about it, so shout out to those guys. I think that's really the only Zodiac news that I've seen come across my desk, Mike. I don't think there's much else going on at the current time, so it's a sitting and it's a waiting game as usual, guys. But in the meantime, Zodiac Files episode 4 is coming soon. Subscribe below, join the memberships if you please, or the Patreon, and find all the rest of my links down there below. I think that's it, guys. I was hoping to get Holly back in here, but I think she had technical difficulties. But at least we got a majority of the info. So feel free to leave what you think in the comments, guys, of the show and of Holly's stuff, and of course of the Shel Cavalli suspect with Mike. I'll drop you out if you're all good, Mike. Thanks for your time.
All right. Thanks a lot. See you soon. Bye,
good
everybody.
Good show, man. See you soon. Bye.
Thank you.
That's it, guys. Zodiac Files episode 4 coming soon. The Gavita Beach murders. If you got anything for me real quick, you guys can shoot it out to me. But I'm probably going to dip in about a minute and a half here. Not much else. You guys saw the schedule in the community tab. We're going to do probably either the Crow or Monkey Man review Saturday. Leave us a vote on which review you want. We're going to have a reaction to the Crow 2024 trailer. It looks bad. Basically, this show, probably a part 2 with Holly, possibly Mike. And more interviews coming up. More things going on soon. That's it for me, guys. I hope you guys like the show. And feel free... I could compare those books, but that's on you to compare those books. Flack Nasty, get Mike's book. Check it out, see what you think. All right, guys, I'm out. Like, sub, share. I did not end that properly. You guys got a bonus ending. Dune 2 review is up. The One More Shot review is up. What else? The Roadhouse 2024 review is up. Go check those out. Like, sub, share. We out.